You could have told me 10 years ago that I would have a master's in psychology, I'd own my own company, I'd have finished my bachelor's in fine art, and I'd have exhibited internationally. I would not have believed you. Reason being, I left with 5 GCSEs, and they were a struggle to get, because like a lot of people who have complex disabilities or illnesses, the educational system isn't tailored to us. In conjunction with my ataxic CP, I have a number of cognitive delays, including my audio and visual processing, and my short-term and long-term memory. My short-term and long-term memory in particular were a particular hazard when it came to exams. I want you to imagine this. When your short-term memory is horrible, but your long-term memory is insanely good, and you sit down, you read a question, and your brain's formulating this amazing idea, and great answer, and you can see this is like A stars, and it's amazing, and then you go to put your pen to paper, and that small action makes it completely erased from your mind. That was what I went through every exam, constantly. And I had 50% extra time, read or scribe, didn't matter. The small actions of creating the thought into a verbal response or moving my hand to paper were enough to remove the thought from my mind. The irony being is that I can now remember pages and pages of my math exam because my brain decided to shove that into my long-term memory. So, exams weren't tailored for my brain, like many others. But that didn't stop my love of learning. I decided to go down a BTEC avenue. I did a media BTEC in creative media production for a year, and I loved it. It re-sparked my love of learning and education. I went and I moved on from there after a year with a distinction to do art for 2 years. Loved it. Left with distinction and 5 offers to go to universities and top universities around the UK. When I was at university, I immersed myself in the practicality of it. How can I adapt my skills and my way of doing things in my own brain and my physicality to be a positive? And I made some of the best work I ever have. I don't think I'll ever make better work. As a fine artist, that was probably one of my shining moments. But I left having done international exhibitions. I left being an elected member of the student union. I left with a 2-1. And with so much promise and aspiration in entering the art world. Then I started to face more and more the discrimination and harassment and ableism that a lot of disabled individuals face in the career world, which I'd only faced in education prior. I was entering a world where getting a job with a physical disability was incredibly hard. And even though I knew my own limitations, on paper they would see the description of my disability, they would Google it, and they would say no. Which unfortunately I think is what a lot of us did face. And it's a hurdle, even now I'm still trying to understand and move past and help be an activist against. But I finally managed to land a job in a boarding school. I did 2 years there. And what that did was give me the practical skills of working with people. I was both an academic aide and I worked as a house parent. I was able to work in this environment with teenagers and help with SEND needs and art needs and, you know, be the person they would come to if they had any pastoral questions. And it sparked my love of psychology more than my art degree ever did. You know, there's only so many times you could create an art piece that says, let's explore the mind. Whereas talking with individuals and listening and using those active skills really sparked my love and engagement of learning and education and psychology. And whilst that job had pros and cons, both on my physical and mental health, I left to go on and do my master's in psychology. which was something I never thought I'd do. I made sure to find a programme that didn't have exams and was practical based, and used it to my advantage to work with my breath. And I graduated with my master's last year. And I remember I sat down and thought, I'm really proud of all these skills. I got a job in learning design that I love. But how can I use all of these skills that I've gathered in art and education and psychology and my own personal experience to create something that will help others in the future? And I remember I had this big question that came up, which was, if we went back to the beginning of where all of this started from, my love of education and questions, it was when I was a child, because I was inquisitive. And I'm a big believer, just because your health's changed doesn't mean that your inquisitive nature has. And I had parents who were supportive of this, and doctors who were as well. So I was constantly asking questions. But I remember realising, in my big mind map, there were no tools available for parents and children in conjunction to talk about disability and illness, and not just in a singular product, or, you know, pamphlet, self-help book, but the number of conversations that kind of come along. In fact, that's what I wrote my dissertation about, was the parent-child relationship when health is a factor. And one of the big things we realise is that a parent's mental health is one of the big things we realise is that a parent's mental health and a child's mental health are both affected by how we handle the information from a young age. Any parent here will probably tell you this. When you have a kid, you want the best for them, you want them to be happy, and as they grow up, you will constantly worry about them. Even as adults, you will worry about them. But that weight is also a lot heavier when you have had to raise a child who has more complex needs. And that turns into quite significant mental health struggles. So, we wanted to create a resource that not only included both parent and child and was centric around both of them and helped their well-being and mental health, but also helped encourage conversation between them at the child's own pace, with tools that parents could use to help explain what was going on. So Gradatim, the company I created, we create staggered children's picture books that explain disability and illness-related news to children under the age of 5. And this can go from diagnosis, hospitalisation, treatment, to remission, or recovery, management, palliative care. We want to make sure that the resources are available to include both parent and child, and that's where I think innovation needs to continue to occur. I had a meeting with an advisor who was genuinely thrilled by the fact that our company has no competitors. And I remember I said, yeah, well, actually, I would really like there to be some competitors. And he looked shocked at me, and he said, just because you're a competitive person? I said, well, partially, but mainly because by having other competitors out there, it means that other people are realising the problem. And more people are trying to find ways to push through the problem and come up with answers. And at the end of the day, yes, I am a business owner, but I am a person with cerebral palsy. I'm a disabled individual. I've had parents who've had to raise a disabled individual. And I know when I have kids, they will have questions about my disability. And I want tools to be able to explain appropriately what's going on that won't affect their mental health, won't affect my mental health, but will support and encourage us through our conversations. And that's where I think the advancement and innovation around learning and health resources and education need to occur. Thank you.